I don't know what it means, but it's too much to bear. If I had taken my time, counted my steps, I might have no regrets. You must still be here yet, and not in my dreams. It's too late to care.
This is John Johnson for KPBX-FM, and welcome to Johnson's Improbable History of Pop. Born in Ballyshannon, County Donegal on March 2, 1949, Rory Gallagher was living proof that, to paraphrase the Bonzo Dog Band, Irishmen, if not blue men, can play and sing the whites. He received his first guitar at the age of 9 while living in Cork, South Ayr, and first fell for the blues by listening to American Armed Forces radio. His first professional experience as a guitarist was in the Fontana, or Impact, show band, who he played with for 2 years starting in 1963. In 1965, he quit the show band, where he had specialized in Chuck Berry recreations, and recruited bass player Richard McCracken and drummer John Wilson to form an early version of the band Taste. The group played in Ireland for nearly 3 years before moving to London to take their chances at landing a recording contract in 1969. Two studio albums were recorded for Polydor Records, the second of which, On the Boards, drew a rave review from Rolling Stone magazine and some American airplay. Sadly, Taste broke up at the end of 1970, although two live LPs were issued later. But that's getting just a bit ahead of the story. My guest for tonight is Ben Upham of Spokane, who is a longtime Rory Gallagher collector and a keeper of the flame. And Ben, just what made Taste stand out from the pack of the many other blues rock bands of that period?
Well, I think the initial comparison would be probably with the other trios that made it, the power trios that made it big in the late 60s, speaking of Jimi Hendrix and, of course, Cream. And while Gallagher had a lot of the same talents as them and could rock as hard as they could, I think he had a lot more diverse musical direction, as you'll hear. He did acoustic numbers, he did jazz-influenced numbers. I compare him with those bands, but I think he takes the power trio format into a whole new dimension.
One of the things you mentioned were his jazz influences, and we've been speaking a bit about that off mic. Rory was an accomplished alto saxophone player, which he played on at least two or three of his albums. We'll be hearing some samples of his saxophone playing perhaps a bit later. That's one example. The other is that he also played harmonica. And as you mentioned, there are multiple influences apparent throughout his career. What are we going to be hearing first?
First, we're going to hear a cut off the very first album he did with Taste in 1969, which is a power rocker called Blister on the Moon. Follow that up with a very delicate acoustic song from his second album, On the Boards, which was recorded in 1970 with Taste. And then we're going to hear a cut off of his first album with his new band, recorded in 1971, a self-titled album, and the song we're going to hear from that is called I Fall Apart.
And that new band was the Rory Gallagher Band, to keep it simple. Rory Gallagher starting out with Taste.
To think, once you ask permission, when you feel you want to blink, First look left and then look right, and now look straight ahead. Make sure and take a warning of every word we said. Now you lay you down to sleep, make sure and get some rest. Tomorrow is another day and you must pass the test. Don't try and think too different, now what we say is best. Listen little man, you're no better than the rest. At the wayside, all along the road we've set. Smile and look happy, fool, or we'll throw you in the wet. Now if you learn your lesson well and step upon the line, save your breath until forever, we should get along just fine. We'll bend your heart until it breaks, make sure you feel no pain. We don't want to crush you and give you to the rain. But now you want to run away, okay, let's see you run. Run across the frozen air, try resting on the sun. And if you feel it burn you, don't yell out in pain. I wish you had a velvet sponge full of soothing rain. So let's have that stiff upper lip, now take a long deep breath. Close your ears, you cannot hear, the rules are all preset. Thought we were illusions, but we meant the word we said. We're in command, you tiny fly, we'll crush you till you're dead.
Just listen when I say that it's clear that in time you'll come my way. How near, in a year or just a day?
like a cat that's playing with the ball of twine that you call my heart. Oh, but baby, is it so hard to tell the two apart? And so slowly you unwind me until I fall apart. I'm only living for the hour that I see your face, and when that happens, I don't wanna be no other place till the end of time. You'll be on my mind.
We're listening to the music of Irish blues rocker Rory Gallagher on Johnson's Improbable History of Pop with guest Ben Upham. And Ben, one of the things that we mentioned was that Rory went out on his own as a solo act at an early age, 1970, at the breakup of his band Taste. What were the reasons why Taste broke up?
Well, the only information I have on this, John, is that they had bad management, and the members of the band were not happy with the management. I don't know any further than that.
One of the factors that we've talked about off mic is that Rory did not employ any additional vocalists on any of his solo albums that you could trace down. Is that right?
Not a one. He recorded 124 songs over his career that he had written, and I have not heard even a harmony vocal come in other than his own.
What about additional songwriting by band members, or did he do all of the material on his solo albums?
It was all credited to him, though you can tell, as in one of the next songs coming up, Crest of a Wave, the drummer had a very important part in the writing of this song, even though he's not credited, Wilger Campbell.
Now, a lot of solo artists, when they go out on their own, change their personnel within the band like other people change their laundry, thinking of perhaps Ted Nugent, always kind of a revolving door among his musicians. What about Rory Gallagher? Did he keep people from year to year, or did they come and go with the winds?
Well, actually, after Taste split up, there were four different versions of the Rory Gallagher band. The first one lasted for three albums, the second for five albums, the third lasted three albums, and the only one that stayed constant throughout all this was the bass player, Jerry McAvoy. He joined the band in 1971 and was with Gallagher through the end of his career. Other than that, they did change drummers and occasionally added a keyboard player.
So really, for the business of blues rock, that's a pretty stable relationship.
Well, especially seeing them live, there was a lot of interplay between the bass player and Rory. A lot of bass solos versus guitar solos, you know, a few licks here and a few licks there, which was a trademark of his show.
When was the first Rory Gallagher tour of America, and who did he tour with?
In 1973 was the first time he came to the States, opening for Deep Purple on the last tour with Ian Gillan as lead singer for Deep Purple. I think that would have been a great show to see.
So, yes, it would have. What are we going to be hearing next?
What I've got lined up here is Crest of a Wave, which I'd mentioned. Check the drums out in this. I enjoy that a lot.
What year is that from?
1971 on his second solo album. And we'll follow that with a cut from Blueprint, his first album of two that he put out in 1973. The song is an acoustic guitar solo called an instrumental called Unmilitary Two-Step. And we'll end up the set with Tattooed Lady off of the second album he did in 73 titled Tattoo.
That's convenient. The music of Rory Gallagher.
Turn around and wave goodbye, oh.
The music of Rory Gallagher on Johnson's Improbable History of Pop with special guest Ben Upham. And Ben, one of the reputations that Rory had down through the years to the very end was that as of perhaps the hardest working musician in the business. And I guess that's based on a number of factors. About how many live jobs a year did he do?
I heard he was playing up to 200 shows a year at his peak, which would have probably been the mid-70s, 75, 76.
What about tours of America? How many total? Is there an accurate number on that?
There was not very many. He apparently had a fear of flying, which stopped him in the 80s. He was he came over to the U.S. Fairly regularly at the end of the 70s, but only came to the U.S. on two tours through the entire 1980s, which was one in 82 and one in 85, which I was lucky enough to catch a show on the 85 tour. And then he came back in 1991. So it was quite a few years in between there.
What about airplay down through the years? We mentioned that he got some with Taste when they started out with On the Boards. What about for his solo material?
I have never heard a Rory Gallagher song played on the radio, which is why I'm glad we're able to turn that around and get him an hour's worth here. As far as I know, the solo band, Rory Gallagher Band, had only released one song as a single, and it never charted.
Although, looking at the reference books, it turns out he did have a total of 9 top 200 LPs down through the years, but never a top 100 single or a top 100 LP. And at least the second Taste album made it also to the top 200. And another bit of trivia for the chart fanatics is that he did have one top 10 album in England. And guess which one, Ben?
I believe it was On the Boards.
Close, but Live in Europe from 1972 was a hit album in England. And that's kind of interesting in that a lot of English rock bands had much larger followings in the U.S. than they ever did at home, whereas Rory perhaps had equal following on both sides of the Atlantic.
Well, that was a good album, that Live in 72. That's the first I'd ever heard of Rory Gallagher.
When was the first time you saw Rory Gallagher live?
I saw him in 1975. It was a great show at Winterland in San Francisco. He was the headliner, and the opening acts were Gary Wright, who was just doing Dreamweaver at the time, and the Atlanta Rhythm Section, who was really good Southern Boogie. So it was a real, real good lineup. Bill Graham did a good job.
What is it we're going to be hearing next?
We got a cut off of the 1975 release Against the Grain called Bought and Sold, which he always played this song live after he wrote it. It was in every concert I've ever heard a tape of. We'll follow that with a cut off the 1976 album Calling Card. The song is called Country Mile, which was, I saw him do it as an encore in Seattle in 79. And we'll finish up with one of my very favorite songs, a good blues, Fuel to the Fire, off of 1978's Photo Finish album.
Rory Gallagher.
but you didn't have a stitch. Always been out of the limp. I've been hard to mend like a kick in the shin. You always see me smile when I beat up a country mile. Fun on the beat, light of mission to move. Something to prove, an itch in my shoe. I heard the wheel of a train from a burning stack and I jumped on the back. Yeah, the engineer threw the switch. Should have got my brain, I've never been the same. You only see me smile when I eat up a country mile. Yeah! Gotta make tracks, gotta lose some rust. Crease my heels, I race the bus. Don't blink your eyes, you won't see me again. And I'm running it. I ran before I could walk. Fast at the fair was hardly ever there. Saw an eight with a move, and I couldn't choose, I just had to prove. You'll only see me smile when I eat up a country mile. But I was born on the side of the road, a gap in the hedge. Did you hear what I said? Born in a house with no stakes, but I wouldn't switch, I didn't have a stitch. I've always been out of the limb, I've been hard to mend like a kick in the shin. You'll only see me smile when I chew up a country mile. Woo! Gotta be tracks, gotta raise the dust. Grease my heels, I'll race the bus. Don't blink your eyes, you won't see me again.
Thank you.
As we mentioned briefly, Rory Gallagher was noted as one of the hardest working musicians in the business, and he always gave a good live show, did he not, Ben Upham?
Oh yeah, he was full of energy. The minute that he burst onto stage, he was just a lightning bolt.
You mentioned that sometimes he ran on stage, literally?
All three times I saw him, yes. He ran on stage, and he would usually initially go down and start shaking people's hands before he started playing. As well as you see a lot of artists do that at the end of their show, Rory would come out and greet you with a handshake.
Kind of the precursor to football teams coming out through the huddle and slapping high fives with their fans before the start of the game, I guess.
Yeah, well, he got himself good and pumped up for the show.
Stepping back a few years, we've talked a bit about a movie that was made in the mid-70s. Tell me about it, about that.
Yeah, it's there's a soundtrack to it which most people might be familiar with. You've seen it on vinyl, Irish Tour 74. There was a full-length movie, 80 minutes long, that went with this, and it actually opened up the Cannes Film Festival in France in 75. Was very successful, and unfortunately it's not available through regular sources. I'm lucky enough to have a copy, but it's you can't order it.
Can't order it.
No. If you ever find one, let me know. I'd like to get a fresh one.
Through yours truly, Ben can be contacted, if you wish. But looking back a bit, what else might be out there that is going to be released in the future for collectors and for Rory Gallagher enthusiasts? Were there a lot of archives?
Well, something you turned me on to today that I didn't know about was his most recent releases before his death were the G-Man series of official live bootlegs. They include multiple versions of some songs, but apparently they're all live. I was not aware of this. Gallagher was also working on a couple of new albums at the time of his death.
And his death came when?
He died on June 14th of this year. After complications, he'd had a liver transplant in March, and he had some infection in his chest, which led to pneumonia, and it finished him off in June.
His health had been declining for a few years?
I would guess, being that he needed the liver transplant. The last couple photos I'd seen of him in the 90s, he had gained quite a bit of weight. And, yeah, I guess he was doing fairly bad at the end there.
What is it we're going to be hearing to close out our tribute?
Well, we're going to go back to 1979's Top Priority album for Follow Me. Very high energy, wonderful song. And we'll close things out with a cutoff of his last release, Fresh Evidence, which came out in 1990, called Heaven's Gate. We'll see how much of that we can fit.
Let's get to it. Follow me.
We'll be right back.
The music of rocker Rory Gallagher and guest Ben Upham. Any last thoughts?
Well, I hope people appreciate this, and I'd like to come back sometime and play some live stuff I've got.
Good possibility for a future episode of Johnson's Improbable History of Pop next week. Wilder than Little Richard, authentic, crazed, slurping rhythm and blues from the 50s that makes Little Richard look tame, if you can believe that possibility. The music of Escarita will be featured. This is John Johnson for KPBX FM, and thanks for listening.